Welcome to section 5.10. All right, gentle people, in this lecture, I want to go ahead and talk about ideal gases. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to start out with the formula PV equals nRT. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to divide each side by nRT. So what I get is PV over nRT should equal 1. And this is what I'm going to go ahead and graph on this right-hand side. So what we have is PV equals nRT, and this line at 1 represents an ideal gas. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a look at real gases, and they are depicted in the blue, black, and red lines. Now what you guys will see is the closer it is to this one line, the more that gas is behaving ideally. So let's go ahead and take a qualitative look at this. What you guys will notice is that as I increase my pressure, which is on the x-axis, what you guys will see is the further and further I will get from this ideal line. So what that is saying is that at low pressures, I am behaving more ideally. What we can also look at is temperature. What I have is 203, 293, and 673. So I'm getting progressively hotter and hotter temperatures. And what you guys will notice is the hotter I get, or the higher temperature I'm at, the closer I am to this ideal gas behavior. What I can say is if I take real gases, they behave more like an ideal gas at low pressures and high temperatures. Now the question you might ask is, why do they behave like ideal gases under these particular conditions? And so we can first remember some of the tenets of KMT. In KMT, what we did is we assumed that the gas itself took up zero volume, and there were no attractive forces between each one of the molecules of my gas. So here's the picture that we envisioned, but here's what happens when we have a real gas at low temperatures and high pressures. What you guys will see is that I will have these gas molecules, and they are taking up much more space than the ideal gas version. They are taking up room in my container, so I don't experience the full volume. What you will also see is I have interactions between my gas molecules. And so these are the attractive forces drawing my molecules together. Again, these molecules might behave like a bar magnet, so they're going to suck up close to each other and draw each other closer together. Now, that's not to say that we can't correct for these factors. In fact, this equation here is the van der Waals equation of state. And what it does is it looks at the ideal gas law and adds these fudge factors or correction factors to compensate for these characteristics that real gases have. So let's go ahead and take a look at this. What I have is I have an observed pressure. I have my volume, which is the real volume of my container, equals nRT. So this is essentially PV equals nRT. But let's take a look at some of these correction terms. The first correction term that I want to discuss is B, and this is related to volume. So remember, if I have a container and it is a liter in size, according to KMT, an ideal gas experiences that full volume. The gas particles itself, the ideal gas, do not take any volume up in that container. I'm talking about the physical molecule, the gas particles. But a real gas is going to take up space. It is matter. So to correct for that, I'm going to take the number of gas particles I have, or the moles of gas particles, and times it by this correction factor B, which is related to the size or the space that molecule takes up. So that's going to be my volume correction. The next term that I want to talk about is my A term. And A is the measure of attractive forces between each gas molecule. So let's go ahead and think of this. If my gas particles are attracting each other, that means they're going to spend less time hitting the walls, because they're going to spend more time hitting each other because they're attracted to each other. If they're hitting the walls less, that means the observed pressure that I measure is going to be less than if it was an ideal gas where they are not attracted to each other and hitting the walls more. So what I have to do is I have to correct for my observed pressure. Now, it's a little bit more of a complicated term. It's going to be based on the number of moles, the volume of my container, squared, and this A term measures the attractive force. And remember, I have to add to this because my observed pressure is less than it would be if it was an ideal gas. And doing this gets my van der Waals equation of state. Now, what I want you to understand is both A and B are empirical values. And what I mean by that is that these values have to be determined by experiment. People go into the lab and measure these specific terms. So here are my A and B terms for a number of gases. Now you guys can see a couple of trends here. So if I take a look at this section of the noble gases, as you go down the periodic table, you get bigger. And what you guys will notice is as I get bigger, my B term starts to increase and goes up and up. And so this should make sense because B is related to the size of my molecule. And so if I have a multi-atom molecule like CH4, you can see that this and CO2 have rather big B terms. Now, we're not going to be discussing polarity in Chem 1A. The only polar molecule or molecule that acts like a bar magnet that I want you to know of is water. And what you guys can see is water has a very high A term. It has one of the highest A terms in this whole list. And that's because water acts like a bar magnet. And this is in contrast to some of these lower noble gases, which have a very low A. Now, one thing you should note with these correction terms is they kind of have the opposite effect. I have to add to my pressure and I have to subtract for my volume. And so these corrections have opposite signs and they tend to cancel each other out. And so this is why we get to use the ideal gas law, even though it's not 100% correct. It does a good enough job to describe real gases. Well, I hope that made sense, and remember to stay safe, Chem 1A.